Today, I want to talk with you about loving like Jesus loves. How has Jesus loved us? John 15:12. This is my commandment, love each other in the same way I have loved you. Now, we all know that. We all can quote that over and over again. But he was very specific in what he said. He said, love each other in the same way I have loved you. Now, that's what we're going to look at. He knew you before you were born. We're talking about how Jesus loved us. He knew you before you were born. He drew you to himself. He saved you. He redeemed you, justified you, and set you apart for himself. He has sustained you, healed you, protected you, taught you, corrected you, provided for you, revealed himself to you, given you his word, and empowered you with grace to live by his word. He's taken up residence in your spirit. He speaks to you. He reveals his word to you. He watches over you night and day. And he delights in your friendship with him. He loves you with an overwhelming, comprehensible, and eternal love. He will never stop loving you. And he's looking forward to receiving you into his eternal presence. He also watches day in and day out to see how much you're becoming more and more like him, how much we are loving each other in the same way that he loves us. You see, church, no one can live obedient to the word by being a hermit. Our sanctification, our being set apart, our being transformed into the image of the Lord is directly related to how we relate to each other. My goodness. There are only two topics, church, in the Bible that are so important to God that he devoted an entire chapter to each one of them. The first one is in Hebrews 11, the power of faith. The second one is 1 Corinthians 13, the power of love. 1 Corinthians 13. If I could speak all the languages of earth and of angels, but didn't love others, I would only be a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I had the gift of prophecy, and if I understood all of God's secret plans and possessed all knowledge, and if I had such faith that I could move mountains, but didn't love others, I'd be nothing. If I gave everything I have to the poor and even sacrificed my body, I could boast about it. But if I didn't love others, I would have gained nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. Prophecy and speaking in unknown language and special knowledge will become useless, but love will last forever. Sooner or later, church, everyone gets hurt. We may get rejected, let down, talked about behind our backs, judged unfairly, or terribly misunderstood. We may have a conflict with somebody we love or stabbed in the back by someone we thought was our very good friend. Looking at you, as I say this, most of you are already picturing a face. You're thinking of someone who's done you wrong or seriously has disappointed you. Somebody's done me wrong, song. It happens to all of us. It happened to Jesus. He said so. Matthew 13. He returned to Nazareth, his hometown, and when he taught there in the synagogue, everyone was amazed and said, "Where does he get this wisdom and the power to do miracles?" They all scoffed. "He's just the carpenter's son. And we know Mary, his mother. We know his brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judah. All his sisters live right here among us. Where did he learn all these things?" They were deeply offended and refused to believe in him. Then Jesus told them, "A prophet is honored everywhere except in his own hometown and among his own family." This crowd demonstrated what it means to be easily offended and even deeply offended. You do realize, don't you, that if you are easily offended, you will find it difficult to consistently walk in love. So what does an easily offended person act like? They're overly sensitive. They get hurt easily. They take everything personally. They dwell on past hurts instead of letting them go. They have a hard time accepting criticism. They make everything about themselves. They hold grudges over small issues and measure everything that happens by their emotions instead of by the Word of God. Now, I think it's time for me to bring up the fact that I didn't write the message. I guess what comes to the forefront, do we need to stop right here and repent? Well, some of you think so. The rest of you think, well, yes, they should. I would think most people in here say, well, yeah, dear God, I've been waiting on them. They ain't repented or come and apologize yet. Like it or not, God will use the offenses in your life to make you into what he wants you to be. Amen. And you need to write that on the tablet of your heart. Listen to me. It often takes the worst things done to you to bring out the best in you. You need to grab hold of that. There is a level of maturity in God that you will never reach unless you pass the test of being offended, and by his grace, getting through it with love. Amen. And not with anger. Amen. Rather, the mandate for our way of life is love. Not a sloppy or self-serving love, but the Jesus kind of love. Compassionate, gracious, slow to anger, abounding in goodness, kindness, faithfulness, mercy, and generosity. But don't try to be kinder than God, because God does address things. So keep in mind, as we come to a close here in a second, we're talking about loving like Jesus loved. So love is patient and kind. That means you will have some obnoxious people come across your path just to test you on it. As I've said before, you may move away from them. Somebody else will move in until we conquer that issue. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. Apparently, some people will have something you wish you had, and so you will get a big head, and you'll end up not talking nice about them. It does not demand its own way. It means you cannot be a 2-year-old toddler for the rest of your life, throwing temper fits. Temper tantrum. Thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you. temper tantrums. That's it. Glory to God. There's some people that think they have a right to just do that all the time and to spew out on other people. It's not irritable. Talking about love now. It's not irritable. It keeps no record of being wronged. We need to stop and repent right here, all of us. So if you've got some little black book in which you wrote down all your offenses, Jesus doesn't keep a record of your offenses. Amen. So how dare you keep a record of somebody else's offenses? Amen. Then love does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He will clarify things. Love never gives up, never loses faith, always hopeful, endures through every circumstance. Like it or not, you do not just walk away from a relationship because you got your feelings hurt. Amen. What I just read to you, church, is the guideline and the pattern for loving like Jesus loves. For loving like you've never been hurt, and for loving supernaturally. That passage in 1 Corinthians, we read it at weddings, but it's actually a mandate to every follower of Jesus for every single day of your life. So, how are we doing with patience? How's your kindness doing? Well, kind of so-so. What about humility? Have we overcome jealousy and pride? Are we rude toward each other? Now the Lord's gone to meddling, hasn't he? You want to raise your hands? I didn't think so. Do we insist on our own way all the time? Are we easily irritable? You might as well go ahead and say yes. Oh, I'm not talking about you. We all, when the Lord asked that question, I said, the answer to that is yes. Yes, we're easily irritable. Do you keep a little black book with a record of all your wrongs? If you do, he said, burn it. Amen. So as we come to the close, loving one another is far more than birthday cards and forced smiles on Sunday. Loving one another means graciously helping someone when it's inconvenient or interrupts your own plans. Well, I mean, I'll help anybody as long as it doesn't fall on this day and that day and the other day and whatever I got planned. Loving one another means keeping a confidence, refusing to gossip under the guise of sharing a prayer request. Let me just say this. When you need to talk, and when I said, let me just say this, I'm still quoting from the Lord. When you need to talk, talk to someone you trust, not to a motor mouth. Amen. It just ends up being gossip. And then loving one another means looking for the best in your brothers and sisters instead of the worst. It's extremely easy to be a fault finder. Anybody can do that. Anybody can. Loving one another means being truthful with each other. You don't have to try and be someone you're not. Just be real. Another aspect of being truthful is not being selective to whom you will show love. Like being kind to certain people if you think they got money, opposition, and rude to others. You don't do that. Right. And then in summary, loving one another means caring more about your brothers and sisters than yourself. Genuinely, and devotedly loving one another, church, is the fulfillment of the Father's dream. For it glorifies the Lord, edifies the church, and will accelerate your transformation into the image and likeness of His beloved Son. And that's how we're supposed to be growing and becoming like Him. He gave us some very good signs and language and directions, didn't He? Lord, help me to love like Jesus loves. Amen. Won't you stand?